looking at the monitor. He's going to get. There we go. There we go.
There we are. Greetings, everyone. Welcome to the Independent Producers Organization Live Showcase. And we're looking forward to, again, to this today. We're having a call in from Frosty Woldridge. And he's called before, just can't get enough of what he has to say, what we have to say about the population situation.
Interesting.
And how it's getting out of control so fast. And we have to deal with it in some way. While we're waiting for the call in, I just wanted to something for you to think about. I might even mention it again later. You know, it took millions of years to make the oil that we're using right now in our cars and everywhere else. And we're burning it up in 100 years. We're just using it all.
Really?
So what's going to happen? I mean, what has happened to the climate because of that? And how are we going to, it's going to come to an end. We're going to run out of oil, and that's all there is to it. And I'm certainly concerned about what's going to happen at that point. If there's not so many people, it won't be so much of a problem. Because, for example, they'll go to electric cars and things like that. Just having less people makes all the difference in the world. But the real problem, and that's one of the problems, the real problem is the number of people on Earth. Right now, there are 65 million people that are in some degree of homelessness, roving over in the third world, maybe here in the United States, not so much here, but over in the third world, in the other country, Europe, those are just people on the move that don't have a home, according to the United Nations.
Caller online.
Oh, do we have our caller?
Yes, I guess he is. He's online. He says he's online now.
Go ahead.
Okay. Frosty? Are you there? Sometimes it takes just a bit to get him.
To get him going in there? Okay,
To get it going a little bit.
Frost, if you're there, just yell out to us. Or maybe he's still ringing there. We'll just keep talking to
okay.
him. And tell him to come on in when you
right,
get it.
Right. Well, I'm just trying to say that right now, people are just, the human race is just exploding.
Yeah.
And people don't realize they have to do something to stop. Now we have birth control. We have everything now. All we have to do is start using it. I realize it's other countries that seem to have a problem, but
we have a problem.
Are overpopulated too, and we really can't take a whole lot of additional people coming into the United States.
Well, Richard, do we understand it here in the United States? Well, that's why we're doing the show.
they understand to the people that United States citizens,
right?
That's speaking very loosely. Mm-hmm. Have understood and reduced the number of children to where it averages 2 per family or whatever, and less. 2 and less. No other country really does that. Some of them just go wild with the number of children they have.
And on the illegal immigration issue, you know, they said it's a problem there because in all due respect, they're having a lot of kids.
And,
once they're here, you know, they get to be legalized automatically. And then we got the other issues. But my point is that I'm just saying, are we in the realization that that is a problem as far as the overpopulation? I'm just not necessarily picking that issue because it is an issue right now nationally about the illegal aspect of it.
The average American, I don't think it's worth understands that.
They don't understand
because you would hear evidence. Every day, well, you're not trying to have too many babies, are you? You're not, have you taken birth control? In other words, people aren't talking about it and thinking about it and realizing that they have to do that.
they're taking sides of it a lot of times, you know, from the standpoint of saying, well, those poor kids and the whole issue of the, this is America and we're a country of immigrants, and, you know, we understand that, but do they understand this overpopulation thing and why there is a sort of a lack, if you will, of educating folks about the fact that there are just so many mouths you can feed, you know, within a population.
You know, one of the problems is everything's so perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, everybody's got a car.
Yeah.
I drive down the street, just endless rows of cars, or go by a school, like Portland Community College, just in filled parking lots. Every person that's going to that school must have a car. It's incredible.
A lot of food is being thrown away. You know what I mean? There's a lot of food that's being thrown away. In stores and this, that, and the other, and recycling stuff, this, that, and the other. So, but again, this issue here is something that you don't see this on the news. You get me? You don't see those discussions talking about population.
It seems to come in differently.
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's almost an article about the homeless on the Tribune almost every issue. Almost every time there's something like that. And then Oregonian has some of that. But they don't realize how that's part of it.
It is part of it. I mean, you got to find homes for those folks.
Well, that's right. And I guess, who's that? Mayor Wheeler is trying to do that.
He's got his problems, and hopefully we'll talk about the next hour. So he's got his issues. Trust me. I take it our guest is not there yet. Is he on the phone? Check.
He's on the phone, and he can hear you, but we just can't get him.
Tell him to just intervene once you think you got him on. Yeah, okay, good. No problem. Okay. But this gentleman, you know, we talked with him the last time about this whole issue.
Well, it's a
I thought it was
different
very
person.
Educational.
You know, David Paxson.
Oh, it's a different person, but from
he
the
had
same
a place
arena?
Called a balance, use the word balance in his stuff.
Balance.
Negative population growth. Mm-hmm. That's the publication of his paper.
Okay.
Negative, and that's what he's pushing for. Mm-hmm. It's just to go down on the number.
Is that a non-profit corporation, or is it?
I think it is.
A government association, a government.
All these are non-profit, and these guys go in the hole, doing all this work.
Really?
Oh yeah, I mean, this guy here, Frosty, a retired school teacher, taught math and other stuff. So he's done what he had to do to make a living. Of course, the thing is, he bicycled all over the world. He was able to do that and still survive.
Well, you think
I don't know.
At some point in time, if he's picking up these facts, I mean, the government is out there, that, you know, Department of Human, whatever, you know, or people, whatever, you would think that it would stick on the wall or something, and it becomes an issue. And they'll have the discussion and talk about a solution, right?
Okay.
But the bottom line, I don't see too much of this discussion being on the tube. You know, CNN and Fox got their own thing.
Right. I'm trying to use the right word here, two problems. One is the ancient religions that keep pushing, especially Catholic, that comes to mind, to have more and more children.
Right.
Although they never tell you to stop having children.
Right.
And so that's one aspect of it. And it's very unfortunate. They just don't stop and realize you can't get to the top. You can't get to the Pope and say, hey, listen, don't you see what's going on here and what's going to happen in the future if we don't slow down and stop?
Yeah, well, I think about China. I think about India. I mean, those are some pretty heavy, heavy
nations. The thing about China is right here. And China, they travel on 50-lane freeways.
Okay.
And what they do is they keep building. The government keeps responding to the population. You want more cars. Okay, here's more cars. Mm. Okay, you want to tear down more forests and build more malls and everything.
Wow.
Okay, we'll tear down the forest.
Wow.
You can have what you want. they just don't seem to stop.
And then the pollution. I mean, and then you get the air.
Oh, it's unbelievable.
And these people wearing masks. When you see the media stuff, the news stuff, these people are wearing masks to go to work when they get up in the morning. And I mean, just on, it's like a
okay.
thing. Yeah, you know, I mean, it's really bad.
Well, the what comes out of the rivers is raw sewage.
Wow.
And all the endless chemicals, and it flows out into the ocean, and somehow, some way, that's going to get all around the world, and it's going to come back.
You mean
here.
Tell me they don't process that stuff like we do?
Well, we're not perfect either.
I know, but at least we're doing something.
Like Trump says.
But we are doing something, right?
Yes, we do more. I think we do more. We try to cut down on the stuff that comes out of smokestacks and everywhere else. I don't think we've done as good a job as we'd like to. Mm-hmm. And so, yes, that's very hard. The other thing I was trying to say is politicians are the other problems, and talk show hosts. Mm. They know we don't want to hear anything about too many people.
Right.
We don't want to hear anything about it. The more people there are, more votes we get.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
How could that be? That's mm-hmm, a terrible way to look at
mm-hmm,
it.
Mm-hmm.
So,
because you're right. Because the whole issue of this, the immigration issue that we have in this country, talking about the whole issue of illegal immigration aspect of it, you know, when you think about the people that are impacting about it big time, they don't understand. First off, you think about Mexico. Right up front with you, our neighbor, if you will, mm-hmm. Neighbor country, right? And they're from Catholic background, okay?
Okay.
And then secondly, the feeling is if after, let's see, it was after two amnesties. There were two amnesties here in this country where they basically gave them citizenship, two times.
That's happened in the past three, four, 5 years.
Right. And that was under, I think that was under former President Bush, not Bush, Junior, but Bush Senior, and former President Reagan. Remember, those were the two presidents that did this piece.
My understanding is the huge volume that came in was brought up by Robert or Ted. Was it Ted? One of the Kennedys.
It was. Well, I'm just. But
65.
We had two.
And it just opened the door.
It opened the door, and they never talked to that piece during that particular time. And now we got a real problem because those people feel that a lot of people feel that, well, hey, we need to come here. And a lot of these people, in all due respect, are from families that are already here. I'm talking about citizens that are here through those two amnesty areas, and in addition before that, right? You got me. So,
right.
So a lot of those families just started coming in. Yeah.
And then they take
and
the position
kids,
now. They don't want anybody to break it up.
They don't want to break it up. Well, naturally, families are saying, hey, look, these are moms and grandmas and this, that, and the other. And then they're having babies.
That's right.
Babies have grown up and they're having
babies.
And
then they become citizens.
And they're having babies now, see?
That's the whole idea. It's expanding. It just keeps expanding outward. Exponentially is
and no one as far as our elected officials and people that we elect I'm talking about Oregon, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everything is focused on the i.e. the national scene, if you will, the White House and Washington D.C.
Okay.
But no one wants to focus on local issues like Oregon and the various states. They've got elected officials too, but they're not responding to the issues in the respective states. They're just kind of letting everything flow down to the White House and Washington, right? You got it?
That's a lot of the way things are going now.
So realistically, we should be spending more time cleaning up our own house as opposed to dealing with the White House.
Well, our state should just do what we have to do.
But we're not doing it. Those guys are just getting elected and putting it off on someone else. And that's why those two, in all due respect, the two major parties, both Republicans and Democrats, if you will, have never solved the problem. You see, I mean, they only benefited during the time that they're elected or not, but they don't respond to the problem, even though those folks are elected to us initially. So my position is very simple. You deal with the problem at home first before you start dealing with somebody else's problem. See, so when you got our congressional delegation, if you will, right? Our congressional delegation. I'm talking about, we got two senators, we got Wyden, Ron Wyden, and we got, what's the other?
Jeffrey or
yeah, right.
something like that.
And then we got our congressman and our major congressman in this area, in the Portland area. Anyway, but my point is that we got a congressional delegation here.
Oh, yeah. Is,
but the fact, man, we need to spend more time on these folks, those folks, and say, hey, address these issues. A lot of folks don't understand. It is a government of the people, by the people, for the people, right? Right. They work for us, right?
That's right.
And, and so we should be able to tell them, get the job done.
Right? What are you going to do about the overpopulation crisis?
Ask the question. And then let them go on. You got the staff and this, that, and the other. Do, and go out there and get the research and find out if it's a problem. You know what I'm saying? And, mm-hmm. and get it done, because people are divided. A lot of folks are divided. We're trying to figure out what to do. We're spending a lot of time on, everybody's got their own culture.
Mm-hmm.
All the languages and whatever that we're dealing with. Yes, back then. You know, now it's English as a second language. And people don't even understand that piece.
You know, there's 800 different languages spoken in New York. Pardon?
He's not here. We don't hear him. We don't hear them. We're not hearing them.
Oh.
Okay. Okay. Well, as soon as we get him, we'll just keep talking.
Oh, I thought he said he was there. No, he said he couldn't.
No, he's talking to this guy. He's trying to repair it. Okay. Oh, bear with us, folks. If you're looking at us at this point right now with Richard and I, just bear with us. We're having some technical difficulties, and they'll be corrected here very shortly. But we're going to get in. We're just kind of sharing a little bit. If you can hear us, we're sharing with you what the discussion will be about, right,
yeah,
Rich?
Yeah, we.
And we're talking about overpopulation, and it has all sorts of ramifications on this deal. And like I said, by the way, and don't be harsh on the criticism. These are opinions, you know what I mean? Mm-hmm. These are opinions. These sort of folks are out there and trying to get as much information as they can. But the bottom line is, at the end of the day, we're just trying to informing and educating, right?
Oh, right.
And then hopefully we get the people
who represent. I mean, he seems to be interviewing another person, and I'm not sure that.
No, we're waiting for you now. We're waiting for you. Are you there now?
I'm right here right now.
Well, you can hear us. Okay.
We can hear you.
Okay. Why don't you open him up again? Tell the folks who he is.
He's okay. Frosty Wooldridge. He's bicycled all over the entire world and knows firsthand and has seen firsthand these problems that we talk about here.
Okay.
Go ahead.
Thank you very much, Richard, and your guest. It's a pleasure to be on your program. And hopefully, during this discussion, we all come to an understanding that what's happening to the United States today, as well as Canada and Europe and Australia and places like New Zealand and other first world countries in the Western area of humanity, have all chosen stable and sustainable populations starting in 1970, when birth control became very acceptable and Earth Day mandated that overpopulation was the greatest issue facing humanity. In the latter part of the 20th century, and certainly now in the 21st century. And as a college student back in 1970, ready to launch my career as a math and science teacher, I participated in Earth Day at Michigan State University. So all you Spartans out there, let's give a raw for old Sparty. But anyway, back then in 1970, the planet housed 3.5 billion human beings. And unfortunately, the first world countries decided to engage birth control, and the United States, along with Europe and Australia and certainly Canada, averaged 2.03 children per woman. That's two children per woman, essentially. And those countries became responsible for sustainable birth rates. However, the rest of the third world, which I have traveled across on my bicycle from the Arctic all the way to Antarctica, and across six continents, did not take that heed. And so the third world, which is literally about 150 different countries out there across the planet, screamed ahead with adding another 3.8 billion. And today, here in 2017, there are now 7.35 billion more human beings on the planet, growing by 220,000 net gain per day and 80 million net gain per year, another added billion every 12 years. And we are about to reach 10.1 billion, the UN projections tell us, by 2050, which is only 33 years from now. So the great question that all of us have to ask ourselves, when you look at the ramifications of massive human population growth, is called exponential growth.
Yeah.
The key is, what kind of a planet are we going to hand future generations, and what kind of a planet are we going to hand all of the other creatures on the planet? And, of course, as you said earlier, mainstream media, Charlie Rose, 60 Minutes with Scott Pelley and Steve Croft and Leslie Stahl.
Yeah.
You look at NPR with Terry Gross and Steve Inskeep and Robert Siegel. None of them will touch this, and I can tell you this personally because I've sent all of those media centers my latest book, America on the Brink, the next added 100 million Americans. I've sent my credentials to them. I've sent many of my essays on overpopulation in America and around the world. And yet in 20 years of doing that, and I'm 70 years old, these individuals, their producers and the production assistants and all of the others, refused to literally give any media time to anyone who talks about overpopulation and ways to create solutions. And so it's very frustrating here in the United States, because we are on course to grow from the current 300 million back in 2006. We're now at 328 million. And by 2050, which is 33 years from now, because of mass immigration, we're going to hit 438 million more people. And out of that extra added 138 million people, 100 million will come from mass immigration, their birth rates, and chain migration of relatives. So that's the setting we're facing right now, Richard. Let's ask more questions or give me more ideas, because I'd like to really discuss it in depth.
Okay, well, he's left us overwhelmed, but I know what he talks about. I mean, I've heard. It's just good to hear it from someone else again.
So, what do you think? Why is it not sticking, if you will? With, as you say, you got the media aspect of it. Is it political, or what?
Well, that's a very good question, and unfortunately, the American way of life has been drilled into all Americans that we are a nation of immigrants, and that outmoded paradigm is obviously being proved across the country. There are now seven states with water shortages, starting off with Florida, starting off with Georgia, and then Texas, New Mexico, Arizona, Nevada, and certainly California has been in a grave drought for the last several years. But California, again, adds 1,655 people every single day of the year. That's 24/7, and 98% of that addition, of course, is legal and illegal immigrants. And what most people don't understand is that all immigration is caused by countries that are overpopulated, so much so that they cannot work or feed or house or maintain their own populations, so those populations are on the move. And as a matter of fact, the United Nations right now predicts within the next 10 to 20 years there will be well over 100 million refugees attempting to migrate to first world countries because they simply cannot survive in their own countries. And already, according to the United Nations, 10 million children starve to death every year, and 8 million adults. That's 18 million human beings starving to death in 2017. And for those of you who think that the refugee crisis is really bad coming into Europe right now, or the 1.5 million refugees that are coming into the United States every year, or the 250,000 who are coming into Canada, you have to understand that the Third World takes no responsibility for their numbers. That has been going on since 1970. Wow. When they could have taken, or they should have taken, responsibility, and their leaders started pushing for family planning and birth control, but instead they did nothing because, again, ancient religions like Islam and certainly Christianity and certainly Hinduism and Buddhism and Confucianism and all those different religions simply don't advocate for birth control. Mm-hmm. So Africa, and I just wrote a four-part series on Africa. It's called The Deadliest Birth Rate for All Humanity, and I covered Africa, India, China, and the fourth part of the series is the recipient nations. And here is a really sobering reality check. All those people that are flying into Europe right now, over 1.5 million just last year, and there are millions more that have come before them, they're coming from Africa, but Africa at 1.1 billion people here in 2017 is going to double. Exponential growth rate is going to double, according to the UN, to 2 billion people by 2050 and 4 billion people before the end of the century. So as you can imagine, places like Africa are simply going to exhaust all of their overpopulated citizens into first world countries that took responsibility for birth rates, and then overwhelm all of those first world countries, all Western countries. And then when you get into the next aspect of the deadliest birth rate, India. India, again, and India and China are the two fastest growing countries in the world, and the United States is the third fastest growing country in the world, and it's caused by virtually all immigration. But India grows, and it's 1.252 billion right now, and India grows by between 16 and 18 million new babies net gain every year. Wow. So their citizens are looking for a new place to land, and literally millions of Indians have come to America to escape the compaction of India. And I've traveled throughout Asia, and the same thing's happening in China, even with one-child birth rates. China adds 8 million net gain per year, and so you're now seeing China migrating its citizens into South America, into America, into Canada. As a matter of fact, the town of Vancouver, British Columbia, Vancouver, British Columbia, in the last 40 years has literally displaced all of its Canadian citizens, and Vancouver is now a Chinese city, Chinese language, Chinese signage, Chinese control of all of city councils, and all the Canadians have literally been run out of Vancouver, British Columbia. So you can see this thing is not going to stop. So either we as a nation and Western countries as nations stop mass immigration, or they will simply become victims of it.
That's right.
Well, one of the areas I would like to throw back to you from the standpoint, don't you think that too much of a focus of the folks who are supposed to respond to some of the concerns that you have is pretty well directed to the White House and Washington, D.C., but not talking to those leadership in the respective states, let's say in the state of Oregon? You know, they say nothing. And that's part of that task, if you will, to talk about the issues of their respective state. Any thoughts on that?
Well, yes. One of the things that I've found out as I've tried to interview on 60 Minutes, and I've tried to interview on PBS, and I've tried to interview on NPR with Terry Gross and Steve Inskeep and Robert Siegel. I've tried to get on Bill Moyers, because, as you can tell, I can present this thing very clearly. Right. I have the experience. I have written the books. I've traveled the world to see this firsthand. And yet you have two paradigms in this country right now, and that is the paradigm of the corporate elites that control all of the media, and they have no understanding of exponential growth. They have no understanding of exponential growth on a finite planet. They have no understanding of what is called the water footprint, the ecological footprint, the energy footprint, and the resource footprint. And all of that means is that everything is limited. Mm-hmm. And the more you add more human beings to that finite planet, that finite area, you then have, finally, you have collapse. But in the meantime, all of these elites, whether it's David Muir, because I've contacted David Muir, whether it was Diane Sawyer, I kept contacting her for over 15 years. I tried to get on Oprah. Again, completely do not want to touch this. It's because the different mindsets up there, whether it's Lester Holt or whether it's Scott Pelley or whether it's any of the top, whether Jake Tapper, all, they're all talking about things that mean absolutely nothing when it comes to the survival of our civilization, and they would rather talk about just inane situations, whether it's the Russians tapping into the right. American electorate or who's doing what to whom, and the real issues that we're facing are not addressed. And so when you have someone like me who can speak to this very clearly, who has written books on it, who's written hundreds and hundreds of articles on it with scientific facts to back them up, these individuals that hold the media purse strings simply will maintain and continue the silence, and they will silence not only individuals like me, but I also work with Dr. Jack Elpert at www.skill.org, and he has four big videos at skill.org that are just sobering, and it's called Unwinding the Human Predicament, about overpopulation.
Yeah.
You can go to my website, my Facebook page, Frosty Wooldridge, and I post these websites. If you're listening from someplace like the United Kingdom, which now has 64 million people in a landmass less than the size of Oregon.
Yeah. Wow.
Did you get that?
Wow.
Oregon has 4 million people right now, and they think they're overcrowded.
Jeez.
Well, the UK, the United Kingdom, the British Isles, has a landmass less than Oregon, and yet they have 64 million people, and they're just like Easter Island, and you've all heard of Easter Island,
yeah.
Where four people came in on rafts at one point. They exponentially grew to about 60,000. They cut down every tree. They started carving those big stone faces, which were part of their family. Then when the dead died, they would go into those big statues. And then finally, they simply ravaged each other, and conflict ensued because of food and lack of food. And then, of course, they literally killed each other off down to a very small tribes, and essentially the entire population and all of the tribes of that Easter Island died off.
Kind of.
Well, the Mayans did the same thing. You can go back through history. Jared Diamond wrote the book Collapse. Shows where seven or eight major, the Mayans had slash and burn techniques. They died off because they overwhelmed the food source and the water source. So here's the same thing happening here in the United States right now. The same thing's happening in Canada. And the leaders are actually inviting more immigrants into our countries rather than simply stopping all immigration, because I would ask every person listening tonight, go to numbersusa.org, download the 5-minute video that talks about, and it's titled Immigration, Gumballs, and Poverty. It's only 5 minutes. Once you see that video, 5 minutes later, you will have a complete change of consciousness. And then there's another one called Immigration Off the Charts, and it's a 10-minute video by Roy Beck. And you see that video, and you realize he's showing you what America's going to look like when we reach not just the 438 million in the next 30 years, but we will reach over 625 million before the end of the century. And that will literally deform America into a third world country where we will have acute water shortages that cannot be solved. We will have acute energy crisis that cannot be solved. And we will have an acute resource shortage that we cannot solve. And in the end, it will lead to a collapsing society. And or if it doesn't lead to a collapsing society, everybody in this country, black, white,
yep,
brown,
yep,
red, yellow, will all live at subsistence levels, because there simply won't be enough food. There won't be enough water, there won't be enough energy for them to sustain the American way of life that we enjoy right now. And if we even survive all of that, we are cooking up the planet. It's called catastrophic climate destabilization.
Hmm.
I'll give you an example.
He's right.
The human race now burns 94 million barrels of oil 24/7. Wow. We also burned tens of billions of tons of coal 24/7 around the planet. We burn wood, we burn natural gas. All of that carbon releases into the atmosphere. Before 1850, when Robert Owen started the Industrial Revolution in the United Kingdom, it was 280 parts per million of carbon. And that's been going on for the last several million years, and that's what allowed this planet to be quite a livable place. Well, just in 2013, we reached, 2014, we reached 400 parts per million of carbon. And what that's doing is being absorbed by the oceans and turning the oceans from alkaline to acidic pH. Mm. And that's now killing off the phytoplankton, which create 80% of the oxygen on the planet. It's also disrupting the krill. And for those of you who know what krill is the little squiggly crawfish around the oceans. Humpback whales eat 10 tons a day. 10 tons a day. But at some point, when those krill cannot survive because they don't have the right alkaline pH balance in the oceans, and the oceans continue to warm, what you have is a change of the catastrophic climate destabilization. You get Katrina, you get Sandy, you get high-end typhoons, you get tornadoes in the middle of February. You get all of these massive changes of climate. One of the misnomers of all the media is global warming. Well, you should stop using the term global warming and use catastrophic climate destabilization. It's in my book, and I scientifically show from my experiences while I lived and worked in Antarctica with the top scientists that we are changing the balancing systems of the planet to such a degree that we're offsetting everything that kept this globe in balance. And again, if you go down to the Amazon and the rainforest of the Amazon, and I've been there, I've traveled through the Amazon.
Wow.
We're burning them down at an acre every minute, and losing a landmass of Amazon rainforest to the tune of the size of Oregon each year, and we're losing 100 species of animals around the world every 24 hours. And in fact, E.O. Wilson, the great Harvard scholar and biologist, said that we are on course right now to lose one-third of all animal species by 2050 because of human encroachment. And then again, when you start talking about the rivers, whether it's the Ganges, which I've been on in India, or the Yangtze, which I've been on and floated in China, or the river coming out of Lima, Peru, or the Mississippi River, which I've canoed, these rivers create 20,000 square mile dead zones of nothing but poison where marine vertebrates can't exist. And then that 20,000 miles of chemicals, and there's, again, or 20,000 square miles of literally chemicalized water, that spreads around the oceans. It contaminates all of the marine life. The Fukushima explosion with all the radioactive material has been now circulating around the planet for the last three years since Fukushima. So we're poisoning the food systems around the planet. Even the Mississippi River has a 10,000 square mile dead zone at the mouth of the Mississippi right there in New Orleans. And if you're not sure about what I'm talking about, just Google it. Google Mississippi River and the dead zone. And you will find that it is now 10,000 square miles. If you do the same thing for the Ganges or whatever, any number that I give you, remember, I'm a math and science teacher. I back it up with facts, with science, and with sources so that I'm not giving you numbers that are just pulled out of the sky. These are factual numbers that we're facing. So that, in a nutshell, is what the human race is facing, and the United States is facing it, and it is... It's not a pretty picture, and it's not going to change unless we start changing it. And the key here is that the American people have got to rescind the 1965 Immigration Reform Act.
That's one.
Stop importing 1 million legals every year. Stop allowing 500,000 illegals to come into America. Help them in their own country.
Right.
Help them with birth control. Help them with family planning. Help them with water and food and crop planting. because as you can see from the Roy Beck 5-minute video, Immigration, Gumballs, and Poverty, at some point, every citizen on the planet must stay where they were planted, mm-hmm. stay where they were birthed, mm-hmm. stay where they came into the world and will go out and do what needs to be done in their own countries, because no amount of immigration into third world or first world countries like Canada or America or Europe or Australia will save them. It may save some of the individuals, but in the end, the mass immigration will simply collapse all these first world countries, and so all of humanity will be riding in this nasty, overpopulated boat, and from which there is no escape, period.
Well, far as, you know, the point that you just made with regard that they should stay where they are and this, that, and the other, and respond to the agribusiness and all these other things in yep. their respective area, you made that point. But in all due respect, we don't do that here in these United States. I mean, the states are not, some of the states are not responding, if you will, to the point that you just made.
Well, that's exactly correct. You see, most Americans, and certainly most of the leaders of this country, Arkansas Senator Tom Cotton is the one who has actually introduced, I think he's introduced or he's going to introduce a bill to drastically reduce all legal immigration into the country. And so if there's any chance at all, the key here is to support Senator Tom Cotton from Arkansas. So he's a pretty young guy, so he's got a very articulate brain. He understands exponential growth. He also understands quality of life, standard of living. All of those things will go down if we continue to climb toward that 138 million added people to the United States. So the key is, each person listening tonight, you have got to get into your hometown newspaper. Write letters to the editor. Write an editorial. You have got to go to your city council. You've got to get to your two senators. I've gone to my two senators. I give them a 30-minute speech on why we have to stop all immigration in the United States, and that's Michael Bennett from Denver, Colorado, and that's Cory Gardner, who is from Denver, Colorado. Mike Kaufman is my House rep. I've gone into his office. The key is, you've got to go talk to these reps and tell them what we're all facing if we don't change course. You also, you could go to talk@npr.org. That's talk@npr.org. And recommend top speakers like Frosty Wooldridge, like Dr. There's Dr. All the different, there's David Paxson of populationbalance.org.
Yeah.
He is extraordinary. Jack Alpert, again, he is from skill.org, a brilliant speaker. All of us have great facts and figures and presentations that need to go viral. I've spoken to NBC, Adam Schrager. I have a 3-minute why each state needs to create a balanced population and stop importing all these people. Colorado right now at 5 million is on course to be 10 million within the next 30 years. Mm-hmm. I've tried to change that course by saying we don't have the water, we don't have the highways, we don't have the ability to function if we let ourselves go. Does anybody think that California right now with 38 million people is going to survive another 20 million people, because that's what they're on course to add up to, and that means they're going to go from 38 million to 58 million people. Does anybody think they're going to survive that? And even if the humans survive that, whether it's water, energy, or resources, and then the food, because as you keep, well, I'll give you a really powerful example of how dangerous our population growth is. Right now, in Ethiopia, the ecological footprint for one Ethiopian is 0.4 acres. That's 0.4 of an acre to feed that Ethiopian, to have a little hut, have a little outhouse or whatever, and survive, because that's what they do. But unfortunately, Ethiopia is on course right now to double its own population. Mm-hmm. So we're taking Ethiopians on in the United States right now. But when they get to the United States, they immediately require 25.4 acres of land, which is ecological footprint, in order to build houses, track malls, track housing, fire stations, roadways, and then they have to plant more food in arable land. So 25.4 acres must be destroyed in order to take care of that new Ethiopian immigrant. Well, take 100 million of those immigrants. That's 100 million times 25.4 acres. Everyone listening to this, this is your math lesson. Get your computer out and do this on your computer. This is your math science teacher, Frosty Wooldridge, and this is your assignment. Take 100 million times 25.4 acres for 100 million immigrants in the next 30 years added to America if we don't change course, and you will get a total of 2.54 billion acres, B as in boy, billion acres of land must be destroyed in order to support that 100 million more immigrants into the United States. If you do the same thing for Canada, you do the same thing for Europe, if you do the same thing for Australia, you're going to get some really frightening, sobering figures as to what and how we're going to survive this thing. And that's why, as I sit here tonight and I talk to this extraordinary audience, the key here is not to moan, complain, or grumble. It's not to be depressed. Don't get down in yourself, and don't sit here and worry about anything. You have got to take action. And I don't care if your hero in history is John Muir, or Teddy Roosevelt, or Susan B. Anthony, or Eleanor Roosevelt, or Dr. Martin Luther King. I don't care who your hero is. You have the same responsibilities. You have the same dynamics. You have the same ability to change the course of history by your actions that will become collective. Again, CAPSWeb.org is a great organization run by Joanne Weidman out there in California.
Yeah.
It's Californians for Population Stabilization. Roy Beck at NumbersUSA.org, he's got 7 million members. Join and become a part of the collective of people who think like you, of liberals, of Democrats, of conservatives, Republicans, libertarians, independents. It doesn't make any difference. Black, white, brown, red, or yellow. All of us have a stake in the future for our country and our civilization. So the key is that you take action. Because without action, everything you do is just entertainment. Whether it's the complaining part, or whether it's the sitting in your remote remote control in your Barker lounger, and then all of a sudden 30 years goes by and all of your kids are sitting here in the middle of a population nightmare.
Right. Frosty.
So those are some of the things. 60M at CBSNews.com. That's 60M. That's the 60 Minutes website. Email. Get a hold of 60 Minutes. Tell the producers you want to see Dr. Jack Elpert interviewed on the overpopulation crisis.
Okay.
Or Bill Ryerson from populationmedia.org. Or Jack Elpert, again, at skill.org. Or Dave Paxson at populationbalance.org. Dell Erickson, right up there in Minnesota, in Minneapolis, is a brilliant resource and energy expert. I can give you 15 different ones. On my Facebook page, just ask me and I'll send you all of their numbers. I've got the emails to Bill Moyers. I've got the emails to Leslie Stahl. I've got the emails to Robert Siegel. I've got the emails to a Facebook page. You can get all the Facebook pages to David Muir, to Scott Pelley. You can go to Meet the Press. Put on Meet the Press. Write them that you want to see these top speakers on Meet the Press and Face the Nation. Go to the NPR Facebook page and tell them you want to have a whole series on overpopulation in the United States. You've got the tools in your hand. I'm giving you the organizations. I can give you 15 top speakers. The key is we need to have literally millions of Americans say, we don't want to go in this direction that will add 100 million immigrants to our country. It's going to be bad enough having to deal with our own population momentum, which will add somewhere between 35 and 40 million, even if we did stop all this immigration.
Frosty, let me ask you this. We've got about 10 minutes. I want you to spend a little bit more time on this piece. One, we've got our education system. One, right? You got me?
Yep.
I mean, at one point in time, it was in our education system, this education and information aspect of it. It's not there anymore. On the media side, now remember, now today, it costs you to have media, okay?
Right.
It's not free television anymore. You know, your bill will be running about $100 a month or so. So the masses are not getting educated or informed, okay?
That's correct.
Except on this.
So from your standpoint, can you talk a little bit about getting it into the educational arena, the school system, from K-1 to K-12 type thing? Have you looked at that?
Yeah, that would be a very nice thing. But again, the political powers across the country are absolutely in control of making sure such a curriculum is not addressed.
I know.
They will talk about environmental science, and they will never connect overpopulation in the environmental science. I've spoken to colleges across the country, and even the colleges don't want to hear the message that I bring, even with the slideshow that I bring. But when I give my program, The Coming Population Crisis in America and What You Can Do About It, the college students literally drop their jaws with the facts that
yes,
I present.
I could see that.
And there's no way to run from this. The facts that I present on what we're facing as a civilization, you can't emotionally escape them. You can't. Cognitive dissonance is not going to do you any good. You cannot emotionally mitigate them. You can't kick the can down the road. But that's what we're doing, and that's what educational systems are doing. And so often, I mean, right now today, the average teenager texts on his or her smartphone 3,300 times a month. That's over 100 times a day.
Right.
The average American male watches 4.5 hours of television after work every day. The average female watches around 24 hours every week on the television.
Wow.
So what you have is a lot of teenagers right up through into college totally uninvolved in what's going on in our society.
Yeah.
You have all of these men and women, mothers and fathers,
control,
who are watching TV over 4.5 hours per day, who are checking out. So what that means is everyone that's listening tonight, you're part of the 10%. And 10% of the people are the only people that have changed history, whether it's Margaret Mead or whether it's Eleanor Roosevelt or whether it was Susan B. Anthony who gave women the vote or whether it was Dr. Martin Luther King, who I actually marched with back in 1962 there in Georgia when I lived there in high school. These are the people that changed the course of history. We need to be those people here in the 21st century, and it's bringing your uncommon determination, you and the 10% that understand. I've given enough information on this program that should literally scare the living hell out of every person listening tonight, because if we don't change course, we will become victims in our own country, and at some point, it will be irreversible consequences and unsolvable problems. Because there will be too many. That's why places like China or Africa or even India, they can't. Bangladesh, for those of you who don't know, Bangladesh has 157 million people in a landmass less than the size of Iowa. Get that? 157 million people. That's half the U.S. population living in Iowa.
Frosty?
Yes.
Hold on just a minute. I'm going to try to get in here. We just got, three or four minutes?
Yeah.
Just so you'll know, I already wrote into the letters to the editor, and I told in my letter, I said, when they go back to their country and make it great is what they should do. Well, anyway, the bottom line of all this is we need to have men and women become fixed from the standpoint of reproduction. And women need to continue to take the pill. Abortion needs to be important part of this. It's too important. It's the survival of the human race is really what we're talking about here. And by the way, in case no one's noticed, you don't see anybody that's 20 and 25 years old involved in this. It's people that have some have seen things and how and what needs to be done. They're not just young people. Well, so I'm glad.
Because young people just don't know what's coming at them. Because again, as I said, they're all they got their earbuds in and they're stuck to their smartphones, and they are not aware of what is coming. It's almost like they have a cancer inside of their future. Their future is a cancer that will metastasize until the point where they will not have water, they will not have food, they will not have arable land, they will not have an environment that works, they will not have resources, and they certainly won't have energy to keep them warm. And so that's the reality that we're facing. So it's the rest of us who are aware. And again, when you hear the kind of information that I'm sharing tonight, you create a consciousness shift. In other words, you know what I know.
And they'll fight among themselves.
And that's a critical mass shift. And then when you have enough people to take action, you have what is called a tipping point toward a positive future. And that's what I'm hoping, and that's what I'm trying to get on every radio show in America. I'm trying to get on ABC, NBC, CBS, CNN. Help me get there, because I will speak for you, and I will speak for your children or any of the other top speakers like a Dr. Jack Alpert or a David Paxson or a Bill Ryerson or a Dill Erickson or Kathleen Parker, whom I know very well, and Joanne Weidman at capsweb.org. All of these men and women are top speakers, and they know exactly what I know. And the key is to get us out in front of the media by having millions of listeners go to the phones, go to the email, and make the contacts and push this issue to the forefront of the American people.
Frosty, I got an idea for him. An idea for you, Frosty.
We're just about to be cut off.
Here's the deal, Frosty. In all due respect, we're looking, in all due respect, we're looking for a presidential candidate in the Libertarian Party.
Oh.
Why don't you consider running for president? Therefore, your platform would be discussed during those discussions.
That's a possibility in the next presidential election, because if somebody doesn't start talking about this, the most crucial issue of the 21st century here in America and around the world, the human race is really doomed for some very big consequences, and the American people are in for a very sobering future.
We got to get you in the debates, Frosty.
Yeah, that's right.
You're ready. You've got the background. You know what I'm saying? And success is when opportunity meets preparation. You're ready to go, buddy.
Well, as an old classroom teacher, 9/10 of success is through preparation, and I am very well prepared, and I absolutely have the credentials to become president of the United States.
Well, all right.
I would love to be the foremost spokesperson for the overpopulation crisis and the immigration crisis.
Well,
I'll keep his name. I'll keep your name there, and I'll make sure your name will get to the Libertarian Party people in charge. And we've got your address, you got your phone number and whatever, and maybe you might be able to do an interview, and you might be the next, if you will, the next leadership in the next campaign for the Libertarian Party and be the spokesman.
Sounds good. I'll be there. I also write for Freedom's Phoenix with Ernest Hancock right down there in Phoenix, Arizona, and I've been writing for him for the last 15 years, so he knows me, and he's libertarian.
Well, you understand, you understand where I'm coming from, don't you?
Yes, I do. Well,
Thank you very much for calling in, Rusty. We're going to cut off now because I want to take this show and replay it more than once. It's been a very good show, very informative. So,
awesome. That was good. We got about 32 seconds.
Yeah, that's right.
I thought it was awesome. And then just briefly, education is key. I mean, like I said, you know, the communication is pretty well bought and paid for.
Okay.
You don't have access to it. It's not free anymore. The airwaves are not free anymore.
That's right.
Even when he's talking about the smartphones, those are not free. You can't just afford those.
Right. You got to pay somebody.
You got to pay somebody for that stuff. And it costs you a monthly rate, too, once you get it.
Okay.
So the majority of the population are just don't have it, okay?
Thanking the crew here, too.
There we go.
Thank you. We're back. And this time of year, as a matter of fact, the middle of March, what's right here? The 17th to the 19th. That'd be next Friday to the 19th. I'm pretty sure it's a week from this weekend.
Okay.
And
you want to hold that up for you?
You try to hold it.
There you go.
Yeah, you're doing very good.
You got it right there.
And we usually have an interview with people from this, but the studio was out of order in February, so we didn't do it. As a matter of fact, we missed having Miss Oregon interview too.
So the Portland Roaster Show.
She'll be out there at the show.
Okay, the Portland Roaster Show. Okay.
This is a totally a non-profit situation,
right.
And I just want to go over some of the thing where this money from this show goes. Diabetes Foundation, Ronald McDonald House, Randall's Children Hospital for Cancer, Miss Organization, Oregon Organization for Young Women, and supporting veterans through the Missing in America Project. And I know about this. They're trying to get veterans buried, getting a suitable burial for them. And it's just something that they've just kind of come on just more recently. Oregon Paralyzed Veterans, Disabled American Veterans, Kyron Horman Foundation, Kiwanis Dornbecker Children's Cancer Program are just a few of all these, not to mention money that they invest in helping high school students work on cars, which those cars end up at the show.
Oh, really?
Okay,
a lot of sponsors there too, I see. Got a lot of sponsors too, I noticed.
Oh yeah, right.
All sorts of sponsors there.
So I guess I'm through talking about it. I hope you can make it out to there in the middle of March, 17th to the 19th.
I might add, it's quite a show too. I mean, they have some neat cars and whatever. And in fact, my wife had them at her restaurant, Norma's Kitchen at Jansen Beach once.
Oh.
And we held the event there.
Really?
It was a very successful
a drive-in?
Yep, the whole nine yards.
Cruise-in. Yeah,
the cruise-in. We had the whole nine yards. These are good, legitimate people.
Yeah.
Very legitimate operation, and the money does go to the vets. And that's a good piece, okay?
That's awesome.
So anyway, but I want you to know that Norma's Kitchen did have a show like this for one year. That was about 4 years ago.
All right.
We did that in Jansen Beach, okay? All right.
And also, I see they have special guests, band. And
the whole nine.
That's awesome.
They had motorcycles there too. I mean, it was awesome.
Oh yeah,
it was awesome. Right. We pretty well took up the whole area of Jansen Beach there. I mean, that car's running all over the place.
Right.
It was great. Okay. It was great. Good cause.
Well, anyway,
should support it.
While we're doing this, I'm Richard Carpenter. This is
Ovie Muntean.
Ovie Muntean, and Bruce Broussard, co-host. So. I think our next thing is we want Ovie to tell a little bit about what he does to do with the battle buddies, the dogs.
Well, let me share a thought with him before.
Go ahead.
You got a good introduction here. Ovie's good people. As you know, we've been spending quite a bit of time anyway outreaching the vets as far as their services.
Right.
You know, and the services that are available to them, the ones who have not registered yet, to take advantage of those services and whatever. And, you know, and so Ovie is a good example of a person who's going to, who's basically identified with a number of these services. You know, he's got the dogs, that piece. He's going to talk a little bit about that piece aspect of it. It's my understanding he's written a book, too. I mean, those are the kinds of things that, in all due respect, the Veterans Administration is trying to do everything they can to get veterans back into society.
Right.
You know what I mean? Because they got mental illness, got all kinds of issues in that aspect of it. And so this is something that we're very interested in, and we're very supportive. So hopefully we're going to get from Ovie, get an opportunity he'll share with us what he's doing. One, he'll talk about the dog situation, what that's all about, how he got into it, and who else he's reaching out to on that aspect of it. And he wants to spend some time on his book. I'm interested in his book, what the title of that book is, and what he's talking about in that book. Might fit us, Rich. It might fit us, I don't know.
Okay.
All right, Ovie.
Thank you so much for having me on the show. It's awesome. Awesome introduction, thank you. Thank you for calling me.
Oh, yeah.
Short notice, but that was good.
Yes.
Put me on the spot. I love to be under pressure.
Oh, okay.
This is an awesome show. I'm going to go to it. Hopefully, I make some connections. Yeah. Since they sponsor veteran programs, that would be fitting what I'm involved with, and that's an awesome thing. It's good to be on the show, and it's good to live in the land of the free,
yes,
the home of the brave. Yeah. Thank you for your service.
Thank you.
God bless you.
Thank you, sir.
Same here. I'm involved with Northwest Battle Buddies, a nonprofit organization that serves the veterans with PTSD. What we do is we provide highly trained dogs, professionally trained dogs, to veterans with PTSD at no cost to the veteran whatsoever. Mm. And so, go ahead, feel free to ask me questions. Where do you want to go from here?
How you guys get money to do something like that. I mean, the veteran isn't paying you, and
one reason
you got to eat, and you got to have a place to do all this.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Well, a little bit of history on Northwest Battle Buddies. It has been founded by Shannon Walker. She's a professional dog trainer. She has her own business. She was here on the show a few months ago, yes.
Months ago, right.
And she's donating most of the money. She boards the dogs at no cost whatsoever to the nonprofit.
Wow.
We do have fundraisers. As a matter of fact, thank you for asking. May 6th, we have our sixth annual dinner fundraiser.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
At Embassy Suites Hotel by the airport.
Mm-hmm.
We expect about 500 people. We have sponsors and a lot of donors that have been supportive of what we do.
Yeah, okay.
And it'd be awesome if the show reaches out to the community and they find out what we do. You can go to northwestbattlebuddies.org is the website address. You can also call if you want to donate or you have questions. You can call directly. The number is 360-666-3260.
Okay, one more time on that.
The phone number is 360.
Right.
606. No, 666-3260.
Okay.
Yes.
Okay. Sounds good.
And feel free to throw some questions at me again.
But you threw some other things about it. Well, first off, you talked about the dogs. How does one access being able to get involved? I take it they have to be a veteran, right? Veteran.
They have to be a veteran. They have to be combat veteran.
Combat veteran.
Right.
Come in there with the DD-214.
They have to show the DD-214. Yes.
They have the honorably discharged, right?
Honorably discharged. They they have to have a letter from their doctor.
Letter from doctor
stating
okay.
that they have PTSD.
Okay.
And they can find the application on our website. They can download the application.
Okay.
Again, www.northwestbattlebuddies.org, all spelled out.
Okay, okay. Now, you also, do you basically outreach to the VA to get some of the folks to get into the program?
Yes, we have.
Okay.
We have a very long waiting list already, over a year.
Really?
About a year and a half, yes.
Mm-hmm.
We can only do so much.
That's right.
Yes.
How many you guys, are you doing now? How many individuals are in the program? And two, how long does it take to train a dog, and when do you get those people together?
Okay. We have paired 38 teams.
38 teams?
Right. That's a veteran with a service dog.
Veteran
in the last 5 years, yes. Now, the training...
That takes quite a while, right?
Yes, it does. Shannon Walker explains it much better than I can.
You're doing
but,
good.
Thank you. A dog gets about 340 hours of training.
Yes.
And just to give you an idea what that means, a police canine dog gets about 360 hours of training.
Wow.
I like to joke around and say that the only thing we don't teach a service dog to do is how to bite.
So
actually teach them not
to. They don't have any teeth?
Well, they do, but they do.
Okay, okay.
It's. I think it's interesting about...
So here's the training, how it goes. Shannon Walker picks the dogs, and then she trains them for about 6 months. After that, she pairs them with veterans, depending on their personality.
Mm-hmm.
And then they train together for about 2 months, approximately 6 weeks every day.
They come there, and she trains them there with the veteran.
Yes. The dogs are trained to be able to handle any situation. We take them on in the malls, at cinemas, on Trimax, on buses, at the airport through security. They have to you recognize a service dog by the way they behave in public and the respect they have.
Don't they have a visual cloth or something? Or
yes, they do. They have a vest.
They do have a vest.
Service dog vest. Okay, yes, and it clearly states on the vest that they're a service dog. And so,
service dog usually behave better in restaurants.
Much better.
Where do you get the where do you get the dogs? I mean, the dog pound, or people can contribute the dogs, or what?
Some of the dogs are rescued from the pound.
Rescued from the pound.
Yes,
okay.
And some of them are donated by breeders.
Okay.
Yeah.
So. And what as far as the dogs are concerned, greyhounds. Shepherds or what about those?
Right. German Shepherds and Golden Retrievers are the last
those
five.
Those are ones you're really looking
for. Right, yes. They, Shannon Walker picks them depending on their behavior and their personality. Mm-hmm. They have personalities just like human beings. Mm-hmm. And you cannot give an older gentleman a chihuahua that runs around like too fast, right? Yeah. So she's really good at picking and pairing the veteran with the service dog. Mm-hmm. Yes.
And I know that you made mention about PTSD, and you know I'm very familiar with the mental health services there at the VA and aspect of it, and you got variation, you know, because you got somebody got alcohol abuse, you got meds, all kinds of stuff aspect of it, and then naturally each one of them have their own provider, like their own doctor, so to speak, and that they've got records of these folks. At what point do you think you get to them so that you can, as you're interviewing these folks, right? Mm-hmm. Are you going through the providers and kind of getting their background to see whether or not they can meet the criteria?
Sure, the process of the application, when they fill out the application, I mean, one of the requirements is they have to be clean for 6 months or more. And when we say clean, we don't mean legal. Prescription drugs. So I mean, drugs and alcohol abuse.
Yeah.
They have to have their own place because they have to provide a safe environment for the service dog. The service dogs are microchipped and they belong to No Trespass Buddies. And if the veteran ends up in trouble or homeless, then the dog has to be returned to Northwest Battle.
You just mentioned about the homeless deal, because I remember I was in San Francisco on a little vacation trip and aspect of it, and they got a program where they actually give the dogs to the homeless guys. Mm-hmm. Wow. And they're on the street, whatever. But, but this is a different situation here.
Right.
You can't be homeless. I mean, you have to meet a certain criteria.
Absolutely,
right?
Yes.
You
got me?
And you mentioned you got to be stable. You got to have a place to stay.
Yes.
You got to have. You know what I'm saying? You got to
visit. For a
dog. Yeah. You got to be
for yourself and for the veteran.
You got to be pretty visibly stable. Let's put it that way, right?
Homeless people will pick up homeless dogs, and I guess the dog would be lucky to be.
Yeah. Yeah.
But any kind of. An
but
owner.
They don't give homeless people the dogs.
Right.
No. Well, we strictly.
I mean, I'm just saying.
No. Veterans come first.
Straight, and they want straight veterans. I mean,
yes. I really like what he just said. Yeah. Right. Veterans come first.
Yeah.
And they do.
Right. Right.
And you know, our mission statement states that we are a nonprofit organization providing our veterans a professionally trained service dog.
Mm-hmm. Now, in particular, your particular case, are you a veteran or are you just?
I am not.
You're not a veteran, okay, but
no,
you work with the organization.
Yes, I do.
You work very closely with the organization.
Yes,
okay.
Yes, I am.
Well, that's good.
I do have a son that just returned from combat. I'm sorry, not from combat, from, he was deployed in South America.
Okay.
Really?
And yes, he's a Marine, proud of him. Oh, also, man. I have a daughter younger than my son. She is in the Air Force. She's stationed right now in Okinawa, Japan. Proud of her.
Mm-hmm.
She's gonna be stateside in July. She's coming home.
So you're a military pop then. You cool.
Yes, I am.
okay. Yes, now, there was another interesting thing about your own background aspect of it.
Mm-hmm.
You've written a book, and what got you into that kind of an idea?
That was your father.
Actually, it's my father, yes.
Your father's written the book?
Yes.
Okay.
And it's
good.
The true story of how we came to the United States of America.
We can talk about the immigration piece.
Yes, we can. I heard the gentleman on the show before the show.
Yes, right.
And I think he's right. I have a different perspective. I believe that people that come to the United States of America should come for one reason and one reason alone. And they should come to contribute to society, to the American way of life, instead of coming here and taking.
Yeah, so
there's two different immigrants style. So when we came, all we wanted was an opportunity to work hard and to be free.
So dad was the one that brought everybody home?
Yes.
See, dad, mom?
Yes. My father went on a hunger strike for 27 days. Police and doctors visiting us 4 or 5 times a day.
How many years back?
That was 1981.
1981. Okay, okay.
And Secret Service would come 4 or 5 times a day also, threatening my father, telling him that they're gonna kill him and chop him up in pieces.
And what country was that you talking?
That was in Romania.
Romania,
That was in Romania under the communist
government. I remember those days. Yes, remember those days.
Nicolae Ceaușescu, yes. Tyrant.
Yeah, that was shown quite well.
Yes.
I mean, all over the world for that matter, and how they were treating folks along that line. So basically, that's how you were able to come to as a kid with dad.
Yes, I was very young. He brought out the whole family.
He brought the whole family. Okay, yes. Okay.
And I was young. I was 15 years old. I turned 15 here in the United States. But I grew up there, and you know, I can tell you story after story about how the government treated the people of that nation, and sadly, they destroyed it. But see, Romania was not a communist country. Mm-hmm. Romania was a democratic, free enterprise country. It was called the breadbasket of Europe. Every nation would go to Romania to buy bread and goods.
Yes.
And then the socialists came and promised the people that if they get elected, everybody would have more than enough. Everybody equality, know? And the youth of that time bought into the lie, and and then the socialists also enticed the older generation by telling them that if they vote socialists, then they would receive an Italian tailored suit, free.
Wow.
Back then, just to give you an idea, somebody would have to work a whole year without spending a dollar on anything to be able to buy a suit, an Italian suit.
Mm.
Well, once the socialists were elected, nobody got no suit.
Now, were the socialists from that country, or it was just like a regular another party?
Well, no, actually, it was the Russians coming in to influence, yes.
Interesting.
Yeah, it's the big brother.
So Romania is part of the breadbasket.
Yes, of Europe.
Ukraine, I think of as a
red.
Yes,
same area.
A good farming country.
Right, exactly.
Right,
yes,
right.
Hardworking people.
Yeah, people were eating then.
Oh yeah, everybody was eating.
But then all of a sudden, this other issue came in.
Well, once the socialists came into power, they gave the people 6 months to turn in their weapons, or otherwise face 20 years prison, hard labor prison time. So people started turning in their weapons.
Wow.
Those who refused, they were taken out in the woods, shot, and killed, and nobody ever saw them again. And so once people had no weapons to defend themselves with, then the government did whatever they wanted to.
Mm.
They took the people's land by force.
What happened?
And then they created communists, basically.
What year was this?
I don't want to be wrong. I think it was 1954.
Wow.
Oh yeah.
Yeah, remember.
Okay.
I remember that. But you know what's interesting about I'm talking. I'm learning a little bit more. But you know, you read a lot about it, and you see it on TV and things of that nature. But to really get the realness of what you were seeing on TV, you almost have to have been there.
Yes.
You see, and then too often we don't get educated that way.
Mm-hmm.
You get my point. So you sort of rely, and then you put politics in it.
Right.
And then all of a sudden, there's just somebody just basically just coming here. You see what I'm saying? You got my point? Because we don't necessarily have a similar problem, but my point is that it's different with reference to the issue we're having here right now.
Oh, absolutely.
You know what I mean? And don't get me wrong, I don't blame the people more than I blame the politicians. You see what I'm saying?
Right.
Because those people are looking at like anything else. They want to feed their family. They want to eat.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, and this, that, and the other. And then now we got this situation here now with our illegal immigration aspect of it. And you got the politics in it. And then you got our politicians who's basically overseeing all this thing. And naturally, they don't want any resolution.
Right. No, they don't.
They don't want no resolution. And then we all suffer, if you will. Mm-hmm. And in all due respect, here we go with the media piece. We don't teach this in schools.
Right.
We don't educate the young people in school, so therefore, if you taught them as they were coming up in the school aspect of it, then they'd understand how that all happened.
Absolutely.
Then you'd talk about prevention, so that this situation with the illegal immigration, i.e. with our neighboring country, Mexico aspect of it, then all of a sudden, the issue would be taken care of beforehand.
Yes.
You say, okay, fine, maybe we need to be cautious about amnesty. You know, because that was a political thing.
Right.
That wasn't like that wasn't like the Romanian peace. That's a right. fact. It wasn't mm-hmm. the same thing. So now we got in trouble, and the idea is that people aren't educated, mm-hmm. so they don't understand the difference, if you will. So consequently, some people are combative. They just get rid of them.
Right. And here's the thing: the enemies of freedom, they are not worried about offending anybody yeah. with their. With yeah, what yeah. they say, right? Yeah, yeah. And then we as a free nation, yeah. we have given in to political correctness, yeah, and yeah. we are not supposed to say anything against communism, against socialism, yeah, against yeah. Islam, because we offend them. Mm-hmm. But the enemy of freedom, they come and teach our children, but we're not supposed to teach our children yeah. against the dangers of those who hate freedom yeah. in the United States of America. And what happens is then the young people grow up buying into the lies of the enemies of freedom. Mm-hmm. Look, today you saw it on the news, women bowing down and calling yeah. on Allah to come yeah. here to the yeah. United States. Something's yeah. very, very wrong yeah. when yeah. you have young high school girls believing that Sharia law is better than the yeah. law that we have here in the United States of America that protects every person.
But still, it's an education piece.
Yes, it is. Absolutely.
They were raised that way, and you got to say in so many words, you got to respect, because that's how they were educated.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
You see what I mean? And it was real. You know, but some way, shape, or form, politics get in.
Yes.
It always comes down to the money. Unfortunately, yes. it's about the money. Just like yes. you talked about your Italian suit. You know, mm-hmm. nowadays, it's in all due respect, with the people on the top, and they're buying the gold. You know, and mm-hmm. I've always oh, yeah. maintained you can't eat gold.
Right. Thank
but,
you.
But if you got a neighbor down below that's got a hog or some mm-hmm. some greens or something like that,
right.
I can relate to that because I eat gold.
Exactly. You know, absolutely.
And I realize I'm talking in a kind of a crude way.
No,
with all
okay.
due respect, when you think about the Romanians, that's basically what that was, a food basket thing.
I yeah. don't know how those people ever, socialists ever got their foot in the door. That's just.
Well, what lies? Promising equality, promising wow. that you have everything you need and you don't have to work
well,
so hard.
Well, the people at the top got paid first.
Yes, but you know we cannot have that on Earth.
I know that.
But here's something that really offends me. I want to bring it back to our veterans.
Sure.
You know?
Yeah, okay, let's go.
You know, the freedom we have here was fought for and defended by the men and women that wear the uniform.
Right.
And thank you again for your service. Yeah. You know what I'm talking about.
Oh, yeah.
And when we allow people that hate the freedom that you fought for and you defended, when we allow them to come into this country and milk the system, they come here and the next day or 2 days later, they already have welfare.
Yeah.
They have housing. They demand a cell phone. They have more benefits than you and I that work.
That's right.
Something's very, very wrong with our government. And it's not a government by the people for the people. All of a sudden, they are a special group of people. And that's what socialism and communism is.
Mm-hmm.
A
mm-hmm.
special group, a few, mm-hmm. supported by the masses. Mm-hmm. And they live like kings.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
And
mm-hmm.
they become dictators.
Mm-hmm.
But see, it does such an unbelievable disservice to the men and women that have fought for freedom and mm-hmm. the ones that have sacrificed their life mm-hmm. to make sure the United States of America is a nation under God, the land of the free,
mm-hmm.
the home of the brave.
Mm-hmm.
And now our politicians and those that we elect in power are giving it away mm-hmm. to the enemies of freedom.
Mm-hmm.
We the people need to stand up and support leadership. Those leaders.
We need leadership.
Yes, those leaders that stand for freedom,
yeah.
the ones that love the United States of America and are put in the position to defend mm-hmm. this nation, mm-hmm. you know?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Very important. Well, a good point was the draft aspect of it. See, the draft was kind of our melting pot, if you will. You know what
right.
I mean? The draft to appreciate what this country, mm-hmm. well, we don't have the draft anymore.
Right.
We got a lot of young people there that are just nowhere to go, no education.
Now, we're getting to a point where we probably should hear about your stuff.
Oh, yeah. Well, this is kind of like part and parcel. I can talk about part of that. That's good. Because what I'm doing is that I'm PTSD, and but the bottom line is that my way, if you will, of getting back in society is staying busy, and like you were saying, that when I got back from Vietnam, and I got off the plane up in Los Angeles, they were spitting on the troops.
Oh Lord!
They were spitting on troops. You got me? And so some of the guys would run up in there and change their clothes and just get civilian clothes so they wouldn't be recognized in a military uniform.
Mm-hmm.
And then I can talk about it today, but I saw these young people out there mm-hmm. doing all the yelling and screaming and this, that, and the other, but they had no idea of who I was.
Exactly.
They didn't understand that, you know, I went out there to defend defend their action.
Right.
Give them the right to demonstrate as much as possible. I can say that today. You get my point? And so, again, like I said, that's through the years that has happened to me. And then I got out of the Marine Corps, and then I just basically went from job to job to job aspect of it. And I was from Vietnam. That's when I got out of Vietnam. And then I came here as a Marine recruiter. That's how I came to Portland, Oregon, as a Marine recruiter.
Oh, wow.
And so I got involved in the recruiting aspect of it, and I thought I did a good job, and I gave young people an opportunity to get out of the. I always focus on the young people that were in the jails.
I thought that if you have a criminal record, you cannot join.
During that particular time, we had expungement.
Okay.
During that, we had expungement. So if you ripped off a stereo or something like that, excuse the French, and if you had a joint of marijuana or something, you know,
I'd
take them up to the judge, and the judge would look at them and give me an opportunity to go back in the back and talk to the young man, and if I felt he could make it through boot camp, got me, and he had some sense of character, then, you know, boom, I can't go to boot camp with him, but the bottom line is that, and then the judge would tell them, say up front, well, okay, fine, if you want to consider going in the Marine Corps, we'll expunge your whole record. You spend 2 years in the Marine Corps and you're just like a new man.
Wow.
That's a perfect program, got me? And I felt good about doing that, because now today, I see some of these guys coming back now, they've retired, they got families, for the police, they're lawyers, I mean, they're productive citizen aspect of it.
Right.
And you say to yourself, when I tell my story, I say, why did we quit that? You know, we should have continued doing that kind of deal. So anyway, the long and short of it all is that I was introduced to the services that were offered to veterans through another military person. He was a Coast Guard guy.
Oh, okay.
And so I went down there to check it out, and all of a sudden I'm finding out some of the things that the stumbling blocks I had when I got out of the military.
Right.
They were now being recognizable. And so I had counselors that would sit down with me and talk to me about that and give the stories.
Right.
And then I would have, you know, I'd have issues, you know, because when I was down there, when I was up in Nam, you know, I'm still having dreams and whatever, you know, thinking about the things that were happening during that particular time aspect of it.
Heard about that.
But it's been great for me. And so as a result of that, I started going out and wearing my garb, you know what I mean? So just like you recognize the aspect of it. Nowadays, people say, thanks for serving. See, and not spitting anymore. You got my point?
Right, right.
But they recognize this. They thank for servicing, and that makes you feel good. You get me?
Absolutely.
And so now what I'm doing, I'm trying to contact vets that don't wear the garbs, that are angry, that may be homeless. Like one specific program I'm involved in right now that we've organized, I got some troops together, and we go down to the senior citizen homes. And we have lunch with them. And we wear our garbs, we bring the flags out, and boy, you should see the eyes of the folks, besides the vets. We put the flags in the flagpoles in the stand, if you will, and then we talk about the military, and we recognize the vets that are out there, and we sit down and chat with them, whatever, and then we take the opportunity to educate them about the services that are available. Because a lot of times their family members are with them, you see what I mean?
Yes.
And so we tell them about the benefit, and we leave them one of these basically benefit books. And it gives you everything in there about who qualifies, how to qualify, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then we educate the staff. We educate the staff of that facility. So that now all of a sudden they've got these sitting at the facility. So when new people come in, they can give them a book, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And we've been just going around throughout the county and going out to the various facilities. And that's what we do.
That's awesome.
And it's a fun piece to do. Makes me feel good.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
You are still serving.
I'm still serving. I'm still serving. It's something that I like to do. It keeps me busy. You got me? And then my wife likes it. But my point is that there's a lot of good benefits here. I mean, you'd be surprised of the things you can have. You got civilian health and medical programs. You got caregiver support, death management, education, federal recovery, foreign medical program, Headstone and Marcos. I mean, you got homeless veterans, home loan. I mean, it's like a one-stop city for services.
Right. Mm-hmm.
But in all due respect, there are no cost to veterans. Now, based on your monetary finances, you go through a process. And they check through the IRS and Social Security, and if you fall in a category, I don't know if you're a millionaire, you'll get a card. but some of the, but the services you will get will not be as much as the person down below. You got my point? So it's there, because you never know, you can get you can just lose out on anything overnight, right?
Absolutely.
But the bottom line is there for the vets, and I'm encouraging the vets to get out there. All you do, just call up the VA. Call up the VA. Just call up there. And in fact, you can call up the VA, and as far as VA benefits, you can call them up at 1-800-827-1000.
Yeah.
1-800-827-1000. And what they will do, they will take your name, your last four, the Social Security number, because that's your number.
Yeah.
And they'll check you out. Mm-hmm. And then if you say, well, gee, where is it? They'll ask you, do you have a DD-214? If you don't have a DD-214, they'll send you to another phone, if you will, number, and then they'll take the basic information, and then they'll send you a DD-214.
You got to have your birthday, too.
Yeah, but not DD-14.
Oh, okay.
Yes, a DD-214.
Well, everything would be on there, wouldn't it?
Yeah, that's all you meet right there, aspect of it. Right. So your DD-214, you give them that number, aspect of it, or you can go down to the VA. Mm-hmm. They'll give you an address, and you can go and check in. There's someone in there that'll check you in, and this, that, and the other. Your meds, and this, that, and the other. So in all due respect, it benefits you somewhat too, because if you don't have Medicare or Affordable Care Act and whatever, the bottom line is that you may qualify for that piece. They'll pick up all your medication.
Mm-hmm.
Now all of a sudden, that's your doctor, and that's your Medicare. You know, you can't beat it. Education for kids. If you're a total disabled vet, if you will, you get 100% or so. There's a rate chart aspect of it. Your kids can go to college. They'll pick up the whole college deal.
Wow.
Everything. All for
that's
the kids.
Awesome.
Every dime.
I would like to have
fishing wildlife. You can get a nice discount on your fishing. You can go to all the federal parks, all the state parks. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's a beautiful deal. Mm-hmm. It's all there.
Yeah, but the veterans' kids, they can't like pay them to go to University of Oregon for 4 years.
Yes, pay it all.
Do they have to agree to be
disabled? No. If you're disabled,
you have to be disabled.
If you're a disabled vet, you've been shot or something like that, you can't, your legs are off or this, that, and the other, they will, basically, if you receive 100%.
Yeah, okay.
You get 100%, you know, boom, you can do it.
That makes sense.
I would love to have, 5 or 10 books.
I don't have but one. I don't have but one now, but I'll give you this one.
Okay.
And what you do, and since you guys have a program, what you do, you call up the VA.
Mm-hmm.
You call up the VA. Call the VA benefits, right there, VA benefits, and you tell them who you are, tell them I'm a program or whatever, and this is what I want to do, and this is what I want to give them. And then tell them, you want some of these books?
Okay.
And if you can't get it that way, you got my number. I'm going to give you my number.
Okay.
And if you can't get it that way, you call your local elected federal official.
And they'll have it.
Ron Wyden or Earl Blumenauer.
Oh, okay.
You know Ron Wyden?
Yes,
somebody will have it.
Call him up there and give him up, because he works for you.
Yes, he's supposed to anyway.
Oh, no, not supposed. No, he does. In your mind, he works for you. That's what you got to do.
Thank you, yes. And I do want to say in regards to you, go ahead, I'm sorry.
I was just going to say, a while back, let's say 3 to 5 years ago, there was this huge thing where they discovered that some veterans were waiting months and then dying. And it made a big fuss in the government.
Right.
And I think that's had an effect on everything.
Right. But in all due respect, I will say sometimes politics is depending upon who's running and how, and what they need, if you will, to get elected. You know what I mean? All of a sudden, they started looking at the VA and benefits.
Mm-hmm.
And it also, in all due respect, it kind of started with Obama. Obama, then he jumped in there and he changed it a little bit, you know, because i.e. political reason or whatever, he got in there and changed a little bit, and so now we got President Trump, and now he's saying he want to add a little bit more. So politics benefit us, and from that standpoint,
it's moving in the right direction.
But in all due respect, as people talk about the whole idea of waiting in these long lines, no. I mean, the bottom line, there might be cases, but the fact of the matter is, it's like anything else. They're very familiar. If you're a vet, you're very familiar about standing in line. wait for your services. Mm-hmm. You know what I'm saying? So my point is, it's available.
Mm-hmm.
Everything's available.
Yeah.
You just go up there, and you can call now. You can call. They'll set up the appointment for you. And then you go down to the VA, and if you need your meds, you go there. You can call, and you can even have your meds delivered to your house.
Oh yeah, right.
If you need transportation, you know, all of a sudden your leg, you can't get to the VA. They got transportation that will pick you up right from your home and take you over there. And so it's all there. You just have to spend a little time and read. I mean, when I initially started out, I said, call my number. But I said, hey, it's right here.
Yeah.
All you have to do is just call. That 1-800 awesome. Number. You call that 1-800 number, and then you take your wife.
If that's right.
If you're married, this, that, and the other. And the married, and if your wife, if you're married, they'll give her a little check, too, at times. So you'll get a little pension. So it's not, so all you have to do is have that DD-214, and have that, and that DD-214 indicates that you had you were honorably discharged. If you spent one day in the military and you were honorably discharged, you can get the benefits.
That's awesome. That's great.
You can't beat that, can you?
Well, there's a difference. You had to be in, for certain benefits, you had to be in during certain wartime.
No. Just a veteran. You'd be a veteran. Now, naturally, you get added benefits. Like when in Vietnam, you had Agent Orange. You heard about that stuff, this, that, and the other.
Yes.
Okay.
They had different areas, blah, 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 routine. But in all due respect, if you're in the Navy or you're in the ship or something outside in the water, depending upon where you are, you got benefits. Mm-hmm. If you were in the military and you wasn't even there, but you were in a regular zone back in the States or whatever, working on the strip, the airstrip or whatever.
Right.
Hey, if you got ear problems or you can't hear or all kinds of goodies, you can get your benefits. It's all there.
I agree. Now, I want to make sure you understand. I'm talking about the time being in the service during certain combat times.
Okay, they got an organization called Veterans of Foreign War. In fact, I'm a lifetime member of it.
Okay,
Veterans of Foreign Wars. No. But my point is that you don't have to be there as a veteran. In fact, the providers who actually can fill out all of their paperwork.
Okay.
Are the VFW has the contract.
Right.
So you don't have to have been a VFW person, I mean a veteran of foreign war, to get your complaint. No, you can be any veteran.
Okay. Right.
You have to make an effort to do this.
Yeah.
If you're not
a veteran,
you need to make
But a lot of people still, I don't want to deal with that. I was like that for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And someone came to me just like I'm sharing with them, see? Mm-hmm. And I went down there and all of a sudden, guess what? It's there. It's there for you.
Okay.
And that's okay. So I would say any veteran, if you got a DD-214, you had an honorable discharge, you go down there, there's benefit. Not only for yourself, but also for your family.
That's awesome.
That's all they have, right? And they give dogs. That's kind of like working with him. They can provide the dogs. Mm-hmm. They can find the names and this, that, and the other. They can go to him or whatever. If they're in need of a house, they can come up with a house. If they're disabled, give them a
housing.
Dog. Give him a dog. Yeah.
Okay.
That's great.
Okay.
I'd like to give you a little bit more detail about
the event
we have.
Yeah.
Again, it's May 6th at Embassy Suites Hotel by the airport. And our guest speaker is Lee Ellis. Do you know?
Lee Ellis. Wait,
he was in prison with John McCain in Vietnam.
Yes.
For
really?
6.5 years. Yes. He is our guest speaker. And, of course, sit-down, formal served dinner.
Oh, yeah.
We do everything very patriotic. We do posting other colors, pledge, national anthem, prayer. And so I would love it if you looked this up and came. Again, the website is www.notwestbattlebuddies.org.
I think you have my email address.
Yes, I do.
Okay. Is it on email, this information?
Yes.
Okay,
I can send it to you.
We got all April to...
To advertise. Thank you. I'd really appreciate that. Yes. And we'd love to have you there. It'd be an honor to see you.
Well, let's stay in touch. And maybe we'll come on down.
We'll
come on down. Whatever. Now, what about your color guards? Are you going to maybe contact the VFW or the Air Force or Navy, the Army? You probably already got that all squared away.
We already have that squared away. Okay. Yes. Oregon City High School has been doing it, and they're awesome. They're very... put together
consider,
and professional.
But consider having a veteran color guard.
Okay.
There's nothing wrong with the kids.
Right.
But if you have the veteran color guard, now you can spend a little time talking about veterans. And that's what you're doing. You're supporting veterans.
Mm-hmm.
See what I'm saying?
Absolutely, yes.
See, so that'd be a good deal. And then maybe give them about 10 to 15 minutes talking about the benefits of veterans that you guys are doing.
Yes.
From veterans.
Would love some input because obviously...
I'd be more than glad to help you out with that.
Thank you.
I'd be more than glad.
I know where the veterans place is. It's down about First and Morrison or
Right. Downtown.
Columbia.
Just call the VA. They give you the number.
Yeah.
But then you can go to Vancouver. There are other outlets that you can go. You can go to Vancouver, Washington, right
and
across
get this
the bridge.
Book.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, but
okay.
It's best to call the benefit number, that number that I gave them.
All right.
You got me? And then they'll say, I got it, and this is where it's going to be. Or they'll mail it to you.
All right.
After you, see what I'm saying? Got me?
Mm-hmm.
After
okay.
you get that DD-214.
Okay. Yep.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. I'd rather have a booklet than have it online. I can't look at the computer that
you know,
much.
And let me tell you something else that's really exciting. They got a thing called EVET. You know, and what that EVET thing is that it's like on the, it's on the website. It's your own a filing system. Everything from day one you got in the military, your background material, I mean all your benefits that you have. If you want to apply for benefits in this booklet, you can do it online.
Huh.
Isn't that something?
Oh.
And it's for you. It's just right there. You just going on click it in. You got your password and whatever, and you can just sip that and look at that whole deal. And so if anything happens to you as you get older and whatever, the wife or your son and whatever,
they
have access to your file and contact your provider. This thing is getting to be very sophisticated. It's awesome. That's why I like that photo. I mean, that photo is awesome. See, that photo is always awesome. You know, we need you, right? Federal benefits for veterans, dependents, and survivors.
Yeah.
Wow.
It's an awesome service. It's there for the vets, and they paid their dues for
What's another item or two that you can think of that's in the book?
Oh yeah. Well, burial rights, for instance. You know, we got up right there in Crockett,
okay.
there. You know,
mm-hmm.
I got beautiful burial grounds up there, Willamette National Cemetery aspect of it. If you want to be cremated, mm-hmm. You can be cremated. And then you can put your ashes inside a vault kind of a deal, mm-hmm. aspect of it. Or if not that, you can, you know, they've got grave sites with granite stones in there with your name or whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And you can bury, for instance, a veteran wife can bury their loved one with them.
Oh, wow.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah.
In the same grave.
Mm-hmm.
Isn't that something?
That
yeah,
mm-hmm.
so that's some very interesting piece. That's a major piece aspect of it.
Right.
But the other piece is being able to provide you with a little bit more income, a little subsistence to help you out through the day.
Okay.
Because medical care is high.
Yes,
it's very costly aspect of it. That's a big bite,
mm-hmm.
out of that check aspect of it. And a lot of times nowadays, Social Security don't really provide as much.
No.
You would think it would be just 100%. I mean, a person's already paid for it, and they're telling you got to get this second provider. You got to pay insurance to pay more money to get this one, and this one.
Mm-hmm.
It's crazy as hell. They need to have a one-stop medical for everybody, as far as I'm concerned. See what I'm saying?
I agree.
Then that's the cemetery aspect of it. Then you've got, let me see, where's another good one? You got women veterans, women too, by the way.
No.
Women veterans, they take care of all that kind of a piece aspect,
mm-hmm.
of it. And then they've got education, like I said, the education, if you want to go to school,
mm-hmm.
you don't necessarily have to go to college. I mean, they'll pay the vet to go back to college if he wants to.
And
in some cases, give you a computer, pay the computer, and compensate you $1,000 a month or better.
Okay.
Regardless of how old you are.
That's right, and pay everything you want. And then, for instance, if you want to go to just rehab, go through an apprentice school or something, you know, just a little,
mm-hmm.
like, for instance, like going, you want to be a realtor. They'll pick up the tab for a realtor.
Really? Mm-hmm.
If you got an employer that would hire you, they'll start you. He'll start paying you as an apprentice, whatever the minimum wage for that person. And then as you progress, then you'll go up in the rank, and then the employer picks up the other tab. But he never pays the 100%.
How recent are all these changes? I don't think this was in effect years and years ago.
Not years and years ago.
Okay.
You know, but my point is that, by the way, the benefits, this particular catalog, it changes every year.
Mm-hmm.
Oh,
okay.
This is edition 2014, so it means
But once you call that number and you
right.
get on the, you can get on the computer,
you get the update,
and your updates are already there.
Wow.
See, so this is really not an old one, but it tells you got all the numbers and you got the websites.
Yes.
For all of them.
That.
This is a valuable tool.
Okay, right.
This is a valuable tool. Okay, got me?
Mm-hmm.
And so this, it'd be nice for you to have this.
Absolutely, I'd love to have.
Oh, you got this one. And then, like I said, you got my new, you'll have my number. And if you get any problems, if a VA personnel say you can't have them, you know, your magic word to him is that I'll see you later. And then hopefully you'll get Congressman Earl Blumenauer or Senator Ron Wyden, you know, calling them up and saying, and all you do is tell them, I want 50 books,
mm-hmm.
Senator Wyden, and then he'll get his staff to get it, and he'll be waiting there for you.
Awesome. Thank
is
you
that
so
fair?
Much.
You like that?
Yes. I love that.
You get that, Mitch? You got your benefits, right?
Yeah.
I think that the two of us have been talking so much. Mr. Carpenter, please.
We talk the same. No, we do the same.
We're okay.
No, we're good brothers. No, no,
that's what this is. His
that's what I was
time.
Do.
Okay.
That's
yeah.
his time.
Yeah, that's what I do.
His subject.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
That's so thank you for including me. It's an honor to sit next to a man that served this great nation.
Well, it's an honor. It's an honor to get in your background in terms of your feelings about being an American citizen and why you got here and how you got here, and how you got here. In fact, this country has always been that bright light, if you will,
yes.
you know, to take the folks who are having these kinds of issues and whatever, because they were basically given the opportunity to come here and reside, you know what I'm saying? But that was because of that whole turmoil situation. That's right. Yeah. But we can't forget the benefit and the beauty
Absolutely.
Of what this country is all about. Like
yes.
you said, we got over 100 languages or whatever, and that's the other concern. Mm-hmm. It should be, we got all these languages,
yeah.
we got all these cultures, and that's why
that's
we
right.
have we have English, you know what I mean? It should be English as a first language.
Yes,
and you can,
that's
it
right.
doesn't
it's
say
so
no
much.
To the culture.
Right.
You can still speak your language when
exactly.
you get home with your
yes.
parents, this, that,
Absolutely.
And that. But we're getting away from what we're all about.
But see, it was against the law in Romania to speak English or learn English.
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, probably.
We came here, and within a week, we were registered, and we started going to school at
yes.
night, 6 p.m.
Yes.
to 9:30
yes.
p.m., English as a second
yes.
language. We couldn't wait to learn English so we can
yes.
communicate.
Yes.
We wanted to speak English more than we wanted to speak Romanian
yeah.
anymore because we came into this country.
Yes.
We were adopted into this nation and were given everything.
Right.
Everything that we could have never been able
right.
to have in
right.
Romania.
Right.
And so why wouldn't we? My father refused to stay on welfare.
Mm-hmm.
When he found out we were getting welfare.
Right.
And he asked, where is this money coming from?
Yeah,
when he
yeah.
found out it's from taxpayers' money, my
yeah.
father said, no more. We
mm-hmm.
don't want that mm-hmm. anymore. We can go look
wow.
for work. We went and worked. I was a young kid. I went with my father and worked for $2 an hour.
Yeah, yeah.
Because my father said, we didn't come to this nation to be a burden to
yeah,
this nation.
Yeah.
We came here to add value and to work hard and to earn our own living. But now you have immigrants that come here illegally and
right.
demand everything and more than people that work hard have.
But you know, Dee, in all due respect, you can't look at them more than the person who signs the check. Understand what I'm saying?
Yes.
See, someone said it's okay.
Yes.
They could have said it's not okay, and this is the way you have to do it. Just like when you said English is a second language. See, beforehand, it was always English as a first language.
Yes.
And they would always tell you, you didn't have to not speak your language,
mm-hmm.
but you had, in order to, so that we can all get along together.
Mm-hmm.
You got to speak one common language
yes.
because you know you get out there and everybody's talking different language aspects. I don't know what you're saying.
That's right.
You know what I'm saying?
Yes.
Or,
yes.
You know what I'm saying? I'm trying to. So my point is that we got to go back to what this country. It's all there.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. But we
it
don't
is.
Teach it in the books anymore.
Yes. Isn't it sad
yeah,
that
it,
we don't teach our children the history of this great nation?
Yeah.
But you know, I do agree that once they sign a check, have a responsibility. But you know, it was okay for my father and for our family to receive welfare. They were sending a check. It was up to my father to say no more. We didn't come here to take. We came here to give.
But
and
there
contribute.
Was a start. See, that's the whole
yeah.
idea.
Yeah.
The money initially, just like unemployment.
Mm-hmm.
Unemployment was just a start.
Mm-hmm.
Because most people would just move in with the regular family members
mm-hmm.
and right. just keep working. Got me?
Yeah.
But someone came up with this idea. Well, I tell you what, we're hurting a little bit right now, and we're going to give these people a check. But no one said at the end of the day when they're hurting, well, okay, fine. They're motivated to go and out do it on your own.
Yeah.
They just kept giving it.
Right.
And so
right.
now we've gotten so accustomed to it, everybody's on that kind of a piece.
That's right.
And they take the money and this, that, and the other.
Mm-hmm.
So again, like I said, I don't blame the person more than I blame the person who signs the check.
I want you to, because we're down on time,
mm-hmm.
to summarize
yes.
Battle Buddies.
Okay.
And tell everybody more about that.
Okay. Great. Well, once again, Notos Battle Buddies is a nonprofit organization serving our veterans who served us all.
Yep.
That's what we always say. And what we do is we provide highly professionally trained service dogs to veterans with PTSD
mm-hmm.
at no cost to them whatsoever, mm-hmm. not even an application fee.
Mm-hmm.
Is it in the website under Battle Buddies?
Yes. You can find the application. If you are a veteran, you can go to our website. Spelled out northwestbattlebuddies.org,
yeah.
You can see what we do. You'll mm-hmm. see there's videos and pictures of veterans and our events. There's a detailed description of what we do. And also there's a link to an application that you could print out and fill out and mail it in. There's no cost whatsoever.
And your phone number.
Is it on the website?
The phone number is on the website as well.
Give that phone number real quick, like again, because a lot of times people don't have no computers.
Well, you got a point.
They don't have computers.
It's on the graphic.
We'll get that guy inside the video room.
He says it's on there.
Yes. I'm going to give him his number.
Okay.
I'm going to give him his number. Yeah. Oh, look. Oh, he's got the number. That's what I'm saying. See, he's been listening.
Yeah.
360-666-3260. Some people are blind.
Further ahead than me.
Some people are blind and you're just looking at the picture. Yeah.
And again, if you're interested to be part of Northwest Battle Buddies and our events, you can go to the website. We have our 6th annual dinner coming up May 6th. At Embassy Suites Hotel by the airport. There's a lot of detailed information on the website, what we do, what the event is like. You can see pictures from past events.
Okay.
We expect about 500 people. We also have the traveling memorial wall there. It is the wall with over 1,000 names of all the men and women that have died from Oregon.
Okay.
That served. It's an awesome event. The memorial wall last year was incredible. It was moving. Everybody took pictures with it. Many people came and found their loved ones' names on there and took pictures with that. Also, you're gonna love to hear retired Air Force Colonel Lee Ellis.
Okay, that'd be a good one. I want to make sure I get my last piece in there. My little piece aspect of it, for VA benefits, call this number, 1-800-827-1000. 1-800-827-1000. And make sure you pull out your DD-214, and it's the last four of your Social Security.
Yeah.
And you'll tell that to the person who you're talking to. They'll pull you up on the screen. Only thing from that point on, you got to physically go through the process and get a notarized copy, of the DD-214. And all that does is it gives them a background in terms of where your service record. That's all it is.
All right.
I just want to make sure I give that out. But really, get out and get these benefits. Very important. You got this one guy here.
I want you to hold this up again.
I got it.
All right, and that's the weekend after this one.
What day was that?
March 17th or 19th.
17th to 19th, Portland Roadster Show. We usually have them on the here. We usually have 2 hours with mm-hmm. them. Mm-hmm. The show for 1 hour and Miss Oregon for the second hour.
Mm-hmm.
We couldn't get to the studio. Couldn't work the studio this time. So.
But they're here now with you.
What?
You're here now. You're telling them.
No, we couldn't get to the studio on February.
But you're telling them about the event, though. You're talking about now.
Yeah. Portland Roadster Show.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, you're good.
Portland Roadster Show.
And what day was that?
17th to the 19th, Friday through Sunday.
And where's it going to be at?
Expo.
At the Expo Center.
Always at the Expo.
Always at the Expo Center.
Right.
Beautiful.
Good
piece.
Do you know what the cover charge is there for that?
Well, it could run around $15.
$15? Okay, fine. Like I said, we had a restaurant. We've closed the restaurant then mm-hmm. now. But it's called Norma's Kitchen, and we had one of the events over there.
Mm-hmm.
It's a beautiful event, beautiful cars, a lot of fun. Young folks are going to love it for days. A lot of vets are there, too. May even see some motorbikes.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, you might see a whole bunch of motorbikes or whatever.
I used to take my children when they were little, so a lot of children, families there. I'm sure there's good food.
It's up to you, sir. We got 40 minutes.
Right.
So
and we want to thank our crew for making this whole show possible, everything.
We got 15 people back there in that crew room back there.
Yeah.
He does a heck of a job.
Yes, thank you so much. Thank you for allowing me to be on the show with you.
He does everything.
Yes, he does.
Yeah. Okay, well, we're looking forward. Maybe your event at Embassy Suites, and to the Portland Roadster Show. Okay, so we finally think we covered everything. This is non-profit, totally non-profit.
And then share the show, by the way, with other people. Let people know, because I think the rerun is on...